Hi everyone, welcome back to my next video. Today I want to talk to you about why we become nomads. And the reason I want to discuss this is because I know that when I talk to people about how I live, they either immediately get it and think, oh wow, I wish I could do that, or they think, are you crazy? And I think the are you crazy is slightly more than the oh, I wish I could live that way. And so when people respond to that, their first thought is, well, what a terrible life. And then the next thought is, why would you do that? And so if you have a ready, good, convincing answer to why you want to do that, I think that that makes the interaction smoother. And it's particularly important with family, you know, because your family is going to react, you know, often with why. And if you can't give them a convincing answer, it can be a rocky relationship going forward. But if you can give them a good, solid answer, it might smooth things over. So let me just give you a list, right? Go down the list and I'll talk about them at a little more length. I'll try to be quick as quick as I can be. Reason number one is economics. A lot of you are out here for economics. You have really kind of have no choice. But I'm well aware that there are a whole lot of you that are not out here because of that. So I'm not trying to exclude you. I'm just saying that is a very common reason. And if a relative says why, and that's the reason, tell them. I mean, that if I can't survive and have a quality of life any other way, I think that will help them to understand. If you ask almost any nomad, why are you out here? I think nearly universally, what leaps out of our mouth is freedom. We are free. We are in control of our day and our decisions and our lives. And I think that's probably for nearly all of us, that's at the top of the list. Number three is a better quality of life. And we'll talk about that and what I mean by that in greater length. Number four is a rejection of some aspect of society. Now, that's not universal, but I think it's common. I think a lot of people are out here because there's something about a life, the typical American life, the American dream, that they simply object to, or they're disillusioned with, or they're disappointed with, so they're trying a whole new way. Number five is healing. And a lot of us are here for healing of grief, of loss. Some of us are out here for healing of our bodies. I've actually known a lot of people who were out here because they were sick and they were hoping to get well. We're out looking for healing spiritually. We're disillusioned with our spirituality and we're looking for a new one. The ways we can be healed are, we're looking for healing, are many, but a lot of us are out here looking for healing. And finally, I think a lot of us don't know it, and this is not in a particular order by importance, just how I thought of them. I think we're out here to build connections. We're out here because this is often one of the things we're disappointed with society. We're disappointed that we don't have deep, profound connections with other human beings. And that's what we're looking for. We're looking for a community. And I've seen this and heard this over and over again. I found community when I came out and lived supposedly an isolated life as a nomad. Suddenly, I had more and better friends than I ever had before. So these are the reasons, and I think if you can lay them out to your family and friends, it will start to make sense to them, and perhaps they can embrace your new life even if they don't like it. So let's talk about each one of those in a little more detail now. So reason number one for a lot of you, it's simple, it's obvious. You can't afford to live. You're on a fixed income. You've got $800, $1,000 a month coming in on a fixed amount of money. You can't live on that. You spent $800, $1,000 of it on rent, and boom, you're broke at the end of the month. You're choosing whether you're going to eat dog food or pay for the rent. And so for a lot of us, it's simply so much cheaper. You become the landlord. You pay yourself the rent. That landlord isn't taking that $800 and putting it in his bank. You're putting it in your bank. And it's just that. I mean, it's no more complicated than that. You are now so much better off because you're keeping the rent. And so it's just that simple. You're better off financially and it's well worth it. And that kind of feeds into the second reason, which is freedom. You know, if you have to pay that $800 or $1,000 a month, You have a landlord, and that landlord is the master of your life. The first of every month, or whatever it happens to be, most of us the first of the month, you pay him that 800 or the 1,000, or you're out on the street. And if you're out on the street, your life's going to get really ugly really, really fast. So this man who owns that home owns you. You are his slave. You must satisfy him at all times, or your life gets horrible fast. So what do you have to do? You've got to have the money. How do you get the money? You get a job. So now you've added a second man who owns your life, man or woman, a corporation, not even a human, really, a corporation who is assigned other humans to be your owner and master. And so every week your boss says, I need you to do this and this and this, and I need you to do it now. And you either say yes'm or yes sir and do it, or you don't feed this other master and you're out on the street and your life turns to shit just like that. So now you've got these two masters who are working together, and you don't own your life. Your boss tells you where to go, when to go, and you say, well, I really want to go over there and do that. And he says, oh, you can't do that. You got to come here and work for me. Maybe you get two days off a week. You get a week or two of vacation, 3-4 weeks, maybe, not often. And other than that, he controls your every day. He tells you, you need you to be here at 8, so you got to get up at 7. And if the traffic's bad, you got to get up at 6. He decides when you wake up every day, 5 days a week. And then he decides you're going to go to work. He decides what you're going to do at work. After you leave, you're free to do it yourself, but you've got to be back and chirpy, ready to go the next day. So you got to decide, what am I going to do to keep my boss happy? That really controls the rest of your day. For most of us, it's fight traffic home, eat something quick, sit down in front of the TV, fall asleep, go back to work the next day. Eat, sleep, work. You get a couple days off, but there's so much to do. You run around and you get everything done. You do the laundry and you do the dishes and you run around and do this and take care of that. And maybe you get to do one or two things you enjoy. Maybe you don't. Maybe you don't ever get to do something you choose to enjoy. You just fulfill life's obligations. You don't own yourself. You come out here, you stop paying that 800, you pay yourself, you become your own boss. So it's the freedom. It really is the freedom that pulls us out here. First, the economics, number one, be able to survive and live. But beyond that, it's freedom. And I think we all agree on that. We're here because of the freedom. Number three is a better quality of life. Your life is going to be so much better out here because you're free. And even if you still have to work part of the year, you're still free, at least part of it. And so the stress and the grind will fall away, and the demands and pressures of life are going to just fall away, and you're going to find peace of mind and heart. And I've just found that over and over again, that it becomes a whole package that delivers a higher quality of life in every possible way. You can indulge your curiosity and your imagination. What's it really like over there? I'll go find out. And maybe you can't go everywhere. Maybe you only have so much gas money, but you can go somewhere and you can see what you want to see. We can go back to our childhood sense of play and curiosity. Life can become about playing. Maybe not as much as you want. You can't fly to the Himalayas and climb Mount Everest. That's probably not in any of our futures, but you can drive up to the Grand Canyon, or you can drive over to Joshua Tree. That's not too far away. And you can see something you haven't seen. And your heart can be filled with the joy of exploration. You can become children in a sense again, playing in life, exploring in life. You can go out and make your own mud pies and go out and see the new part of the woods that you've never seen before. And the quality of our life just drastically increases when we have the freedom and a little bit of money, and we can just go live the life we want to live. What that will look like for you will be very different than what that looks like for me or for Susan or for Bill or for Fred, but it'll be my sense of play and exploration, and it will be yours. And you'll live it however you want to live it, not the way your landlord and your boss tells you you have to live it. So I think the quality of our life will certainly increase. Number four is some kind of a disillusionment or disappointment or disenchantment with society. Let me give you some examples of what I mean that will make sense. So, consumerism. I find consumerism, you know, the forces to pushes us and compels us to fall into buying more, buying the newest. There's another guy over here, he's in advertising, and he is an expert at making you wanting things and making you feel like you have to have the newest and best thing or you're a failure, you're a loser. And so this fear drives us to want and just have to have this newest thing. And it's kind of in our heart anyway. And so when he feeds it expertly with his propaganda, we all say, oh, it doesn't impact me, but it does. You feel that compulsion, that consumerism. I got to go out and buy. And I think there's this, in general, there's a real knowledge of the futility of the emptiness of a life based on consumerism. So I think that's a lot of it. And for a lot of us, there's a sense of the way we're treating the earth and despising and fighting and hurting the earth and not connecting to it. I think there's a real sense in a lot of us that I want to reconnect to the earth. I want to go and see it. I want to experience it. I want to be it to be a part of my life. And so there's something about society. And there are others, the rat race, just simply the fact of work, eat, sleep. Work, eat, sleep, buy more crap. You can't afford, get a new credit card. Work, eat, sleep, buy more crap. That just that emptiness and the drudgery and the shallowness of that life. There must be more to life than that. There must be. I wasn't born for this. This isn't my dreams when I was a little boy or when you were a little girl. You didn't dream about this life. If someone told you this was going to be your life, that you would have been horrified. That would be a nightmare life. And so I think there's a sense of, I don't want anything to do with this anymore. I'm going to find my own life. And maybe your relatives won't understand that, but I bet there's some part of them that would love to break out of it. And maybe they've completely lost touch of it, but it's down in there somewhere. So there's this disillusionment with life and wanting a change. Number five is I think a lot of us are looking for healing. You know, I hear from people all the time. I get emails and they tell me about the experiences they've had in life, and people have cheated them and bad bosses and bad corporations, and someone gets a lawyer and steals everything they have and they end up with nothing, and loved ones dying, people that you care so much about dying. That's that, you know, how many of us have had that experience. Just there's this sense of loss and grief in a lot of us. Probably heard of the movie Nomadland that I was a very small part of. And it's really not the story of a nomad. It's the story of this lady who suffered this enormous loss and grief and her healing that she found by becoming a nomad. And I think that's a lot of our story. We've come out for healing. Healing emotionally, and that's what that was, that emotional healing. Physical healing. So there's healing out here, and I believe most of it is in the actual physical act of being in nature. I mean, look where I am, and this is where I live. I wake up nearly every day, and if you really looked around, I've got this picture set up to be prettier than it really is, but it's still really pretty. And every time I step out of my van, I feel a tiny charge of life is the way it's supposed to be, and I'm happy. So the sixth reason a lot of us are out here, and what we're finding, whether it's a reason in our head or not, whether it's conscious, is we're finding a community. So a lot of us are fearful that when we come out of here, we'll be lonely and we won't find friends. But because we all can come out here and find healing, we can also find community. When we find healing of emotions and mind and heart and spiritual healing, we can begin to connect, genuine connection, first to nature, I think, and then to each other, and to make deep, long-lasting friendships. It's, I want to know you, and I want to know you now. And so we connect, and then we go apart thousands of miles, perhaps, and literally thousands of miles, and months or even years, I won't see friends. And then when we come back together, that bungee cord, that connection, whatever that connection is, it's there. It never leaves us. And when we come back together, it's like, oh, it's so good to see you again. It's just like the last time I saw you. It's just this heart connection. And then we build on it, and it becomes, the bungee cord isn't stretched and break like physical bungee cords do over time. Every time we're pulled back together, we share a bond and we share an energy and we become stronger and the bungee cord grows thicker and we're always pulled back together. I see this over and over again. I know, and you'll hear these stories. Okay, I'm gonna stop there and talk. I hope you got something out of this. Albert Einstein asked a question. He said, you can live your life in two ways. You can live your life like nothing is a miracle, or you can live your life like everything is a miracle. And you know, ultimately, this is the reason, I think, that summarizes them all. I come out here and I live my life like everything is a miracle. Everything is magic. My life is surrounded by it everywhere. The connections I make, the feelings I have. My life has become a living miracle. And yeah, there's some hard times. I've had some really hard times on the road, and I think I've talked about them just a little bit, but I don't talk about them much because they don't define me. My life is a living miracle. I won't let those things define me. It's the miracles that define me, and they happen over and over and over and over again. I expect them. I expect nothing less than a life of miracles happening all around me, and you can expect that too. And I really believe that. There are going to be bad times. Miracles don't mean no bad times. They mean a miraculous way to get through the bad times. And that's what I've found, without exception. Okay, I'm going to quit there. I hope you got something out of this video. If you did, like the channel on YouTube, subscribe, hit that thumbs up button, and I'll see you on the next video.